This here is the Beelink SER4. It is a Windows 11 Pro mini PC powered by an AMD APU. It has the Ryzen 7 4800U. It's an 8-core CPU with 16 threads, maximum turbos 4.2 GHz. This configuration that they sent out to me has an ample 32 GB of RAM, 512 GB of PCIe 3.0 storage, and even though it is small, you can install an additional 2.5 inch drive into this to expand upon your storage. It can run three 4K 60 monitors. It has plenty of USB ports on it, gigabit LAN, and very fast Wi-Fi 6E. Included in the box with the SER4, we have a user manual, a HDMI cable that's a normal sized one, a very short one for when you VESA mount it on the back of a TV or a monitor. That's the bracket for that. We have some screws for a 2.5 inch drive and the mounting bracket, and then our power supply. Now this is rated to 57 watts. This mini PC has an excellent build quality to it, and it's very small and compact. So we have alloy that is painted around the outside here. This front bit is a little bit reflective, as you can see, and that's made out of plastic. So we've got a power on button with status LED, a combo 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. This type C port is USB 3.1 with display out, so it's 4K 60, two USB 3s and a clear CMOS. Then the back of it, well, up the top, this is where the vent is, so all the hot air is going to be pushed out the back of this, so important to not block that. Two HDMI 2.0s here, so they are both 4K 60, a DC in there, and another one USB 3, and then one USB 2.0 port here, and gigabit LAN. On the left and the right of it, we have this red vent. Then the top of the mini PC here. So this is a mesh over the top, the fans below, so the fresh air is sucked in directly from here, blowing out the back. Now there's a sticker on here just to warn us that when you turn it on at first, the fans will be at 100% RPM, and that's what it's meant to do, then it slows right down. So of course you do remove that, which I will do now. And to gain access to the internals, it's not that difficult. You've got four screws to remove, and then you need to pry off this lid here. Now, it was a bit difficult, but a little tip here is use the holes here, put one of the screws for the mounting bracket into it, and then use that to pull it out, and that worked for me. But be careful, there's a ribbon cable right here, which I have already undone. That's where the SATA 3 drive is. This is the 2.5 inch bay on the back of it, and we have our RAM. So they've gone with Crucial RAM, and we've got two sticks of 16 gigabytes here. So I have the 32 gigabyte version, and the good news about it is it's Crucial, and we also do have an Intel SSD, which is the 660P series. Below that is where you'll find the Wi-Fi card, where Beelink's used a Wi-Fi 6E card, which is very quick with Bluetooth 5, and it is a MediaTek. It's the RZ608. And note the huge thermal pad, that's giving us contact with the controller on the SSD to then the back where the 2.5 inch drive is. So it's acting as a large passive heatsink to help cool the SSD to stop it from throttling. Our BIOS and the available settings. So this is very typical of Beelink. We have absolutely everything that you can think of that's unlocked to us, which is great. That's why we have that clear CMOS button on it in the front there, just in case you mess up any of these settings. So you can set with the power options to have it power on automatically. If it loses the power state, it'll detect that, turn it on. So you could run it as a server or on a switch. We have RAM disk configuration, which is handy if you want to set that up. AMD CBS, so there are some interesting options in here. There's the AC power loss one that I just talked about, and the CPU ones where you can do a few little tweaks in here, but I'm not going to mess with any of those there too. But it's under NBIO common options where you will find one that's very interesting if you intend to game quite a bit, and that is this, the graphics configuration. You can set the iGPU configuration here onto this one, which is game optimized. Now, if you've got 32 gigabytes of RAM, which this version does have, it will then dedicate 2 gigabytes, I believe, or maybe four, no, it's two, to that Vega 8 graphics to help improve the performance, and it will up the power limit too. But I'm not gonna mess with this. I'm gonna keep it all stock for my review, but it's just to point it out, you can improve the performance if you want. The version of Windows 11 that it does run is Windows 11 Pro, and it is fully activated, which is good. Now in the device manager, you will notice that we do have our CPU that is listed, the Ryzen 7, the 4800U, 16 times here, because it has 16 threads and 8 cores. Maximum turbo is 4.2 gigahertz. It's based off a 7 nanometer process. And the wireless chip that I pointed out when we looked at the internals, if you did skip over that, well, it's a MediaTek chip, very fast, Wi-Fi 6E, so you won't be upgrading this anytime soon. And it does have maximum throughput that I can test it with my Wi-Fi 6 router, about 1.3 gigabits per second, which is pretty standard there with the transfers. So that drive that it does have, the Intel, the P660, isn't really that fast. You can see the speeds that I got out of it with my benchmark show me that for PCIe 3.0, it's on the lower end there. So if you want faster, upgrade that, of course, to something like a Samsung 970 Evo, which would, of course, be perfect. Now, the benchmark scores here, just run that. Because this is a low wattage chip, even though it does have the 16 threads, the multi-core score here isn't as good as it could be if this was an H part. So if it was the 35 watt or 45 watt part, this would do a lot better here. But still, they're decent scores here, so good performance out of that Ryzen 7. And I do have the benchmark here of Geekbench 5. So single core score, they're looking okay, a little low because of that lower turbo there, and a multi-core score, they're nearing up towards 6,000 points. It's not bad, but everything I throw at it, this mini PC does feel very quick. So things like spreadsheets, documents, all of that stuff is going to be very, very quick on it and fast with no problems. So for office work. So what about demanding video files? So this is a Jellyfish file that I test out. Initially does a few stutters, which seems to happen on every single machine that I test out, but once it's going, it's good. It's not dropping any frames there. So that's 4K HEVC, 140 megabits per second. But what about 4K 60 now? So 4K 60, this is the Sony demo file that I play, and this one runs fine, okay? That does not seem to drop any frames at all. So the Vega 8 graphics is doing well there. Quick test now of 4K streaming performance. Now this is with YouTube, it's 4K 60, and occasionally it is dropping frames. You can see it's at 32, and just now and then there'll be one or two drop frames. It doesn't really seem to affect the experience of it. Like, I'm not really detecting these drop frames at all because it's just one or two a second, not even that. So it is, I think, adequate performance here streaming YouTube 4K 60 frames per second. And video editing now. So the Vega 8 graphics is really helping out here, and the performance of the timeline, which I do have the playback resolution set to just a quarter here with Adobe Premiere Pro with these 4K files, does seem to be all right. It's occasionally dropping a few frames, but the overall performance isn't too bad. Now, definitely that 32 gigabytes of RAM I do think is helping out here. Now, this is a basic 4K edit. So what I'll do now is export 1 minute of footage at the 4K YouTube preset. We'll see how long it takes. And here we go, it is finishing up. So it's going to be under a minute, so that's very good. So you can say approximately 48 seconds if you factor in my delay there with hitting start on this timer. So that's not a bad result. So this is a basic 4K edit. Remember, if you are grading and doing all of that and effects, then it will take longer. Now onto the gaming performance. So it has the Vega 8 graphics and it's clocked at 1725, but you see sometimes it scales down a little bit, so it's not holding, unfortunately, that constant 1750 megahertz on the Vega 8 graphics, so the performance could actually be a little bit better here, but still it is playable. This is 1080p on normal settings, and I am getting here around 50-60 frames per second. That's in the car, so as soon as I get out, it'll be a little bit better. And because it's nighttime here, it tends to take a little bit more of a hit on the graphics. So 70 frames per second, it's not that bad, considering it is integrated graphics. It's just that it could be a little bit better because of that GPU clock. I think it's being restricted there by the wattage. That's what's happening. You can see it's hitting the 25 watts. That's why the performance is not as good as it could be. You see, the frame rate's not amazing, so you probably actually do want to run this game. I would definitely be running it at 720p to help improve upon the frame rate there. But it is playable. It's looking reasonably good, as I expected. And it is, I think, just like when I showed you with GTA 5, that the Vega graphics could actually do a little bit better here, but it's that 25 watt power limit that's really restricting it, restricting those clocks, because it doesn't want to go over the 25 watts, so it has to clock itself down. There's a bit of lag around that smoke, quite a bit there.
thermals now, so it doesn't go over 80 degrees Celsius, which is very good. However, the result is the fan is a little bit loud. It tends to be quite aggressive the way it cycles up the RPM. So if you do anything that's slightly demanding, straight away you'll hear it cycle those fans up, and then they drop away as soon as you're not doing anything demanding, which is not too bad. Now, power consumption, I've seen over 54 watts under peak load. That's benchmarking, just pushing it as hard as I possibly could. I do have a couple of things connected up to it, mouse and keyboard too there as well. Idle, it idles around 11 watts, sometimes about 8 watts. It just bounces around a little bit. So it's a low-powered unit, and it does have some reasonable performance in it, but it is, of course, a 25-watt chipset, the APU that's in this. Finally, a look at Linux. This is a live boot image that I'm testing out here, and I run into the problem of the Wi-Fi drivers. So it doesn't like that RZ608 from MediaTek. I need to hunt around, get those drivers, and then Linux should work fine on this particular mini PC.
All up, this is a good mini PC for basic computing. So office documents, spreadsheets, media, stuff like that is going to be good. Even a little bit of light 4K video editing and light gaming, as I showed you, as long as you use lower settings and lower resolutions. So it does have 32 gigabytes of storage, which is ample, 512 gigabytes of SSD storage, which you can expand upon with a 2.5 inch drive. Very easy to install that. You just need to remove the rear off, as I showed you, and then you can slot one in, which is great. So it can run three 4K monitors at 60 hertz, which is good. So what are the cons of it then in my time testing it? Well, it is expensive for the spec, considering it's now two generations old with the 4000 series, and the fan. The fan can be a little bit annoying in this, that it cycles on and off a lot. Well, the thermals are excellent. It just can be a little bit irritating. So thank you so much for watching my review here of the Beelink SER4 Windows 11 Pro Mini PC.